slides over if we have time. We should understand that this particular prophecy is dealing with the New Testament church, but it also includes the what? Old Testament church, because they will not be left out. Can we say amen? All right? So now, let's read. In Zion it shall be said that this and that man was born in her, and the highest himself shall establish her. Verse 6, read. The Lord shall count when he writeth up the people. Who writes the people up? Who wrote that book? I want you to know the Lord is the one that continues to write up the people. Praise the Lord. And I want you to know here, it said the Lord shall count when he writeth up the people that this man was what? Born there. God is the one that has written that book. So now we have come to the General Assembly, Church of the Firstborn, which are where? Written where? In heaven. So the Lord shall count when he writeth up the people, read, that this man was what? Born there. And so those that will be in that number in the New Testament must be what? Born again. They must be born there. Can the church say amen? And that is a water and spirit, that is repentance. Baptism in Jesus' name for the remission of sins, being filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, with the evidence of speaking with other tongues as the Spirit of God gives utterance. This is how we are born again of water and spirit. This is how he writes us up. Well, this is how we know that our names are written where? In the Lamb's Book of Life. If we are born again and we continue in him. All right, that's all we need. Verse 6. We have completed it now. Let's go back to the 12th chapter of the book of Hebrews and finish verses 23 and 24. And what we wanted tonight in our subject is in verse 23. We have come to the General Assembly and Church of the Firstborn, which are written in heaven. Let's read the rest of 23. And to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect. Now, this is what has been born again in our life. Our spirits have been born again. Our bodies, according to the 8th chapter of the book of Romans, have been temporarily adopted into the family of God. Because remember now, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, according to the 15th chapter of 1 Corinthians. So because our flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, and this mortal shall put on immortality. Praise the Lord. This corruption shall put on incorruption. So we will be putting off these bodies ultimately and putting on our bodies which are from where? Heaven. We must understand then that our bodies have been temporarily adopted into the family of God. That means he has placed us or counted us as sons. Naturally speaking, from the natural standpoint or from our physical standpoint for a temporary period. And even though we are still in these fleshly bodies, we are still called the what? Sons of God. Our spirits have been born again. That is, our mental dispositions have been born again. Our souls have been saved. Can the church say amen? This is the way in which salvation has affected each of us as a trichotomy of body, soul, and spirit. And please do not forget it. Can the church say hallelujah? All right. Now then, so we have come to the God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made what? Perfect. But our subject tonight is the church of the firstborn. So we want the early clause of verse 23 to the General Assembly and church of what? The firstborn. Now, when we deal with church of the firstborn, whose church is it? And what's his name? But he is called the firstborn. So it's the church of the firstborn. We should recognize then that this does not have reference to his virgin birth. Because if we look at it from a natural perspective, he was the only begotten Son of God. Naturally speaking, he was born of a virgin whose name was Mary. And none of us can be born that way. So it should be understood in as much as none of us were born in the fashion, naturally speaking, that he was. None of us were incarnated in our mother's womb without the assistance of a man. Can the church say amen? Well, then we must realize he is not speaking in terms from the natural. He is speaking in terms from the spiritual. And we must then look deeper into this and realize this has no reference to the way in which he came into the world naturally, being the only begotten what? Son of God. But this has reference to the baptism at the rivers of Jordan to fulfill all righteousness and the visible manifestation coming upon him in the form of a dove, where John saw him, and he was the first to go through or to set the example for us of the born again experience. He was the first to go through being born of water and of the Spirit. He was the first one to set that example for all of us that follow his example today. And that's how he became the firstborn among many brethren. This is what he's called in another place. Who are the many brethren? We are. Who is the firstborn? He is. For he was the first one to be baptized in water to fulfill all righteousness and receive the visible manifestation of the Holy Spirit coming upon him, Brother Walker, in the form of a dove. Well, let's see to this now. Let's go first of all to see this for ourselves and see this example that he set as the firstborn. In the third chapter of the Gospel according to St. Matthew tonight, in verse number 16, so that no one will count this experience of naught, and no one will discount and make of less importance or mitigate the new birth experience. Somebody said, mitigate, what does that mean? That means to make of less significance. Can we say that? Look that up in your dictionary in your spare time. In the Gospel according to St. Matthew, in chapter 3, we want to begin with verse number 13 and read down through verse number 17 to give you the sense of these verses of Scripture. Now, this is the revelation. How he is the firstborn among many brethren. How we have come to the church of the firstborn. And this should let you know that no one can get in the church but by being born again. Alright, then let's start with verse 13. I will stop you at the strategic places and give you the sense or the meaning of these verses as we go through each of them one by one. Let's begin with verse 13. Can we say amen? Read. Then cometh Jesus from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee. Comest thou to me? Hold it right there. Now notice now that Jesus is coming from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. John is his, biologically speaking, his cousin. He has been ministering for 6 months prior to Jesus beginning his ministry. And John, of course, came preaching, preparing the way for Jesus, preparing people's hearts, preaching repentance, and baptizing people unto repentance. He could not baptize in Jesus' name because Jesus had not yet even begun his ministry. Can we say amen? So he simply prepared the people's hearts to receive the ministry of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And the first principle of the ministry of the doctrine of Christ is repentance. That's why he preached repentance. Because that's the first principle of the doctrine of Christ. And that's all he was given to preach was the first principle of the oracles of God. So preparation to receive Jesus, it's very clear what preparation to receive Jesus is. Preparation is repentance. And if we're going to prepare people's hearts to receive Jesus, we must preach repentance. Now, of course, Jesus comes from Galilee to Jordan under John to be baptized of him. And there's a reason for this, and it will be manifested in the reading. But we should understand here in what we have read that when John saw Jesus, he forbade him, and said, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? And some say, why is John questioning Jesus? Well, it's very simple. When Jesus emerged upon John, Jesus was God manifested in the flesh. And whenever you come into the presence of God, you feel so unworthy. You just don't know what to do but to fall out, fall down. You remember when Isaiah saw the Lord high lifted up, and his train filled the temple, and he heard the seraphim crying, holy, 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 and the smoke of the Shekinah glory of God filled the temple, and the doorpost began to shake, and he looked at himself and said, woe is me, for I am unclean, for this is what the presence of God causes, or this is the effect it has on those with sincere hearts when they come to his presence. Do you remember when John saw him on the Isle of Patmos? And he said his eyes were as a flame of fire, his hair was white like wool, his feet were like polished brass, about his waist was a golden girdle, and he was clothed in fine white linen, and in his mouth was a two-edged sword, and he fell at his feet as though he were dead. This is the effect that God's presence has when you come into the presence of God. You either get out of it or you fall down and surrender. Praise the Lord. And so when John saw Jesus, he felt so unworthy. He fell before him and said, I have need. He may not have physically fell before him, but he humbled himself before him and said, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me, because the presence of God was so strong, was so overwhelming. He was overwhelmed. But Jesus commanded him, verse 15, read, and Jesus answering said unto him, suffer it to be so now, and thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he suffered him. Now the term suffer today means something altogether different than what it meant back in 1611. Back in that day, it meant to allow or to permit. Today it has to do with going through trials, tribulations, or suffering some degree of hardship. And so it would have had a dual meaning back in that day too. But in this particular text, he is saying, permit it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. He was baptized in the rivers of Jordan of John to do what? To fulfill all righteousness. It must be understood, if Jesus had to be baptized in water to fulfill all righteousness, how about you and I? Are we so much more righteous than God that he had to be baptized to fulfill our righteousness as